Good morning, everyone. This morning is Building Fund Sunday, so if I can get the men to come forward and take up that offering, that would be most wonderful. Here to come. Hey, well. Let's pray, guys. Heavenly Father, Lord, you're just such an awesome God, Lord, and we just thank you for the love you have for us, Lord, and just evidence through this building. So many people here that love you that have come here today seeking you, Lord, and our prayers that they come with a heart of worship, Lord, that they come and just worship you in spirit and truth. Lord, we pray now for the building fund that we're taking up to help pay off the mortgage here, Lord, and I just ask your blessing upon it. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. While they're taking that up, I wanted to read a couple cards that we've gotten in recently. We've had a couple great ladies that go to church here. Miss Dolores Nelm, she had surgery recently, and she sent a thank you card to JCC, and it says, "Thank you for the beautiful fall flower arrangement and for all the prayers and support. I am so grateful for my loving church family. Love, Dolores." Thank you, Dolores. And she's doing well here today. Next one is from Miss Helen, who had some surgery done on her back. She was having a lot of pain, and I've been seeing her walk around. She looks like she's doing pretty good. And just want to thank everyone for the prayers. The Jarvisburg Church of Christ, thank you so much for the beautiful flowers you sent me during my recent illness. They brightened my day and were a reminder of what a wonderful Christ family we share at Jarvisburg. Church family, I'm sorry. Your prayers and many kindnesses are example of God's love and the Holy Spirit. Thank you for your outpouring of love and prayers. God bless you all, Helen. So thank you, Miss Helen. All right, so we're going to ask you guys to stand up and let's worship the Lord together.
Blessed be your name. In a land that is plentiful, where the streams of abundance flow, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, or I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name. When the sun's shining down on me, when the world is all that it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. On the road marked with suffering, through the pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
Give and take away. Give and take away. name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Give and take away. Heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name.
Amazing grace. This is you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to fight. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. My strength is failing. The end draws near and my time has come. Still my soul is still unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never. Your holy name. Yes, I will worship Your holy name.
I have to excuse me, I was all ready for the communion song. I'm like two verses ahead of everything. Good morning. Oh man, this is, I was excited about giving this meditation this morning because it's something that I've been studying intently in school, and it's kind of neat the way God kind of shoves things all together and makes things go his way. So I'm going to kind of throw something out there for you today, and I want you to think about this. Bear with me as I go. This right here, coming to the table of the Lord, is not why we're here today. I know a lot of you are already flipping through your mental scripture and, you know, hitting the iPhone, going, the Bible app, going, now, wait a minute. And the truth of the matter is, it's not really why we're here. The reason why we're here is to get instilled with the Holy Spirit, is to get filled with the Holy Spirit so that we can do things like love God with our whole heart, our whole mind, our whole soul, every bit of our strength, everything. That's why we're here. This is how we get there. Is that better? You're all looking at me with wide eyes now. Okay, man. Ron's back there going, oh, man, he made it. He brought it back around in the circle. But it is absolutely the why we got here, how we get there. Christ's sacrifice was so intense. Think about it for a minute, that crucifixion. Think about the fact, first of all, he starts off by being embarrassed. He gets pulled from those who love him and respect him, and he gets pulled off the hill. He gets dragged down. We stick him in the middle of the square, whatever they called it back then. They stripped him naked, pounded a crown of thorns on his head. Really? What juvenile came up with that? I mean, that's ridiculous. The things that he went through for us to give us a huge, huge example that it is the worst thing that could possibly happen to somebody, wouldn't you say? The crucifixion, the beating that he took. I mean, the cat of nine tails, 40 lashes with pieces of leather with chunks of shards on the end of it that ripped the flesh off his back. I know that's very, very pictorial and, you know, typical paramedics got to say stuff like that. But the bottom line is, this sacrifice was so intense so that he could bring you to the table and let you understand that nothing that you have going on in your life is worse than that. It could always be worse. So then we march him up the hill, making him drag his own cross. He falls down three times from exhaustion. And the whole time, check this out, the whole time, something that I noticed in my studies. Did you know, like, the last 25% of the Gospels? The last 25% of the Gospels are all this. They are God giving us specific instructions through his Son, Jesus Christ. And it's the Son of God praying for you and for me. Take a look at the last part of the Gospels. Open it up this week and take a look. It is God praying for you and me. You can't get any stronger, any more pure prayer than that, right? So absolutely. And those two things. And he's walking up the hill so that we can nail him to the cross. And he stops. And he yet again gives instructions to the ladies that are crying. And he says, don't cry for me. Cry for your children and your children's children. He's like, this is nothing for me. It's a lot for me to try and bear and think about. Then we get him up there and we don't tie him up to the cross. We nail him. We drive nails through his hands and feet. And we hang him up on a cross in this position, which if you're in that position for a long time, you can't breathe. It fills up with fluid and mucus in your lungs and you can't breathe. You suffocate and you die right there on the cross. Okay, so there he is, the Son of God. Humiliated in that fashion. And what's the last thing he does? The last thing he does is he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So whatever you got going on in your life, take it to the table, bring it to the cross. And it could have been worse. He could not have risen from the dead. Think of where we would be if that didn't happen. So he did rise from the dead. He did give us the salvation. And he did all that specifically so that we can have the Holy Spirit instilled into our life, the why we are here. He told us specifically after this, after the Lamb is slain, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. Ladies and gentlemen, he's here. I want you to do me a favor today. I want you to pray for me and my soul. And I'm going to pray for you and your soul. You know why? Because we are a body of believers. We are the body of Christ. We are a community of Christ-loving believers who believe in the salvation that he has given us. That's why we're here. That's what you're supposed to be thinking about as we get ready to partake in the elements. Now, the men are going to come, and they're going to pass out these elements, and we're going to take them all together with the reading of Scripture. And why are we going to wait? We're going to wait because Jesus Christ said himself, where two or more are gathered in my name, so I shall be there. I'm there. He's here. Gentlemen.
Chains are gone, I've been saved.
His mercy it rains. Unending love, it's amazing grace. Oh, the earth shall soon dissolve like snow, and the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Oh, will be forever mine. And you forever
God, we love you and we thank you. And dear God, we want to acknowledge that we're blessed. We're blessed so greatly because you allowed your son to go through that ordeal, because he was willing to go through that ordeal that Mike so vividly described to us. We need to hear that description every once in a while, dear God. We know that we need this time of remembrance. We know that we need this juice to help us visualize the blood as it flowed out of him. And we use this bread to help us visualize that sword piercing into his side. And all because of us. We don't deserve it, dear God. And we thank you so much for that grace. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
For I receive from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me."
Lord, we pause now to return a portion of what you have so graciously blessed us with. Lord, may it be used in a way that would please you. May it be used to win souls. For we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
So that's a very, very quick scene from a movie I loved as a kid called Little Giants. The movie is all about the underdog. And we know that there are many, many movies and TV shows and books about the underdog, don't we? About the little person or the person who just has been down and outcast having to come up and overcome, right? Well, that movie to me, when I was that age in the early 90s, I loved football. So I love seeing this movie, which is about a ragtag group of kids who just aren't that quite athletic or used to football, and they get cut from the big football team. But luckily enough, another team gets formed, and of course they got to go up against the Cowboys. And the Cowboys are the bad guys in this movie. So what's that tell you, Dallas fans? Okay. Well, I won't give away the movie if you want to see it, but it's all about these little kids using everything they can to learn how to play one another as a team and overcome this bigger, more athletic, more confident team. And they win the final match with a special play called the Annexation of Puerto Rico. It's just a fun Borowski, if anyone knows what that is. But anyway, that movie reminds me, I can't help but think of it. Everyone might have their own movie or story they go to, but when I think of David and Goliath, I think of something like this. Overcoming is a theme in David and Goliath. And usually, as many of you know very well, that is the primary focus of most sermons and most Bible stories or Bible school lessons that we have about David and Goliath. We talk about how David overcome Goliath so we too can overcome the giants in our life. And I think that's an incredible truth to that story. And we're going to talk about that today. But you see, I don't think that's the most important aspect that most of the time we should be focusing on. I think the most important aspect is simply this, and we've talked about it a lot recently, and that is trust. As a man after God's own heart, David knew that placing his full trust and faith in God is key to overcoming all obstacles that are thrown his way. And this happened when he was just still a young man going up against a huge giant that could squash most men. He had the trust and confidence to face him and overcome him through the power of God. So most of us know this story since we were little, but some people don't. So let me give a quick review. The army of the Philistines and the army of the Israelites in the Old Testament come to battle. Remember, these two groups have been fighting over and over and over again for generations. The Philistines are a thorn in the side of the Israelites, and they just are always constantly fighting. Well, they meet in this valley, and on one hill, the Israelites encamp, and on the other hill, the Philistines encamp, and they're ready to do battle there in the valley. They've gathered. Now, here comes Goliath, an over 9-foot-tall warrior, who comes out, and he challenges the Israelites to one-on-one combat to see who will be victorious, but also whose God or gods are more powerful than the other god. Saul, the king of the Israelites at the time, and the whole Israelite army are scared to death. They're shaking in their boots. They're getting weak in the knees. They see how big and powerful Goliath is, and he's challenging anyone in that army to come forward and go against him. And not a single one out of all the thousands of warriors of Israel are confident enough to go out, including King Saul. And the Bible tells us that King Saul himself was a tall, rugged, strong-looking warrior. When you looked at him, you saw a warrior and a leader. But even he, the one who anointed by God to be the first king of Israel, even he was shaking in his boots. They had lost their courage. They had lost their honor. But most importantly and most sadly, they lost their ability to trust in Almighty God. In comes little David, sent by his father to deliver food to his brothers in the army. He hears Goliath's taunting for the second time and sees the fear in all of his countrymen. And he steps up to the challenge. Long story short, he tells the king that the same God that delivered David in the fields with his sheep from bears and lions, the same God that would deliver him from those beasts, will now deliver him from Goliath. What a powerful testimony. As a shepherd, the same animals and predators that I took down, I'm going to take down this 9-foot warrior. David goes out to Goliath and says this in 1 Samuel 17, starting in verse 45. You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give the carcasses of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel. Never forget, this was a boy, a young man, saying this to a professional, literally giant warrior. Yet despite that difference, he had no fear. How could he when he trusted in the one true God, which means he can overcome this challenge or any challenge before him? There are many ways he does this. How does David trust? How does he have enough trust to get over this? Well, several different ways. David trusted God that no earthly weapon can overcome God's will. Isaiah 54:17 tells us this: no weapon forged against you will prevail, and you will refute every tongue that accuses you. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and this is their vindication from me, declares the Lord. David uses spiritual and psychological warfare against Goliath when he goes out there. He basically says, you done mess up, Goliath. You talk trash, and now you and all your boys are going to get their butts whooped. That's what he said. And you know why that's going to happen, Goliath? Because God's got my back. David confronts this obstacle, and he tells Goliath, I am not afraid of you because God, who is more powerful than you, has my back. And that, to me, is true faith when we're facing fear, when we're facing obstacles, when we're facing sin and other challenges in our life, to instantly say, the one behind me is bigger than you. The one that's going to have my back is bigger than anything you have in your arsenal. Anything. That's exactly what we should do toward the devil. When we are faced with temptations and trials, we need to look Satan right in the eyes, metaphorically. I'm not saying you go find someone, put on a devil costume on or anything. You look Satan right in the eyes and say, not today because God has my back. And you hear people say, not today, Satan, right? Sometimes it's used in a humorous way, but you know what? That's exactly what we have to say. When things are not going our way, when the devil is tempting us, when we're falling short, we need to look him in the eyes. We need to look our sins in the eyes. We need to look those who are persecuting us in the eyes and say, not today, because God has my back. There is no weapon on this earth or in this universe that can do any harm to God, much less conquer him. And if that's the case, if we truly believe it, then realistically, what do we have to fear? How does any underdog defeat a superior opponent? Those of you who play sports or coach sports, you might know this. It's confidence. For David and for us, it's confidence in God's power to deliver no matter what is being used against us. How can anything overtake God when he created the entire universe? When he created everything in that universe? When he has tore down with his power any empire that comes against him? Nothing. Not Goliath, not his javelin, not his spear, not his sword, not his might. Nothing could overcome David if God determined it wasn't going to happen. So David trusted God that no earthly weapon can overcome God's will. And in a very similar way, he also trusted this. David trusted God that the size of the challenge makes no difference. Again, Goliath was over 9 feet tall, and he was arrogant, and he was cocky, and he had the whole army of Israel shaking, including King Saul. Now, if he were 3 feet tall and had a squeaky voice, do you think they would have been as scared? Now, they probably would have went out there and just knocked him over, wouldn't they? But you see, how we view our problems makes a difference how we feel about them. Size doesn't matter to God. Again, he created the universe. And how big is the universe? We can't put a number on it, can we? It's that big. And if he can create something that big, then there's no problem bigger than the one who created it. Doesn't matter to God. And our faith in God can make any large and scary problem look small and puny. Here's what Jesus himself told us in Matthew 17. If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. Now, it's not about literally moving mountains. It's about if we possess a small amount of genuine faith that truly trusts in God's, we would have access to unlimited resources through the power of God. Overcoming sin, overcoming doubt, overcoming addiction or any other temptation, no matter the type or size of the problem, the solution is always equally the same: faith and trust in God. How do we overcome our sins? It starts with placing our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. How do we overcome those sins and trials after we convert? It's the same thing. We place our trust and faith in Christ. It all boils down to who do you believe in and who do you trust? That is the essence of faith, belief, and trust. It's acknowledging it, and it's following through with it. Don't just believe it, follow through. Trust it, obey it, live it. That's what David did in the Old Testament. When you read the story of David and Goliath, it's amazing to see that the size and the might of Goliath, it never fazed David, did it? The scripture never says it, and I believe it. He never once was fazed. He asked questions about what was going on, and you know, he was preparing himself, but he never once said, man, I'm scared too. I don't know about this. And this is coming from a young man, and as opposed to an whole army of seasoned veteran warriors led by a king who was also a veteran. He was never fazed. And that's the greatest example of faith and trust. And we're not always going to reach that sometimes, because a lot of times we are going to get fazed by the things that are affecting us. That's human nature. That's the challenge we have. But when we have that faith and it's on guard and it's ready to go, there's going to be times that we aren't going to be faced because we're trusting in God. We're trusting in that spirit. That spirit that Mike talked about at communion. When God's with you and he's within you, we should have this invincibility nature to ourselves, but we don't always have that because we struggle with our faith sometimes. But truth be told, if we were like David, and if we trusted the power of the Holy Spirit in which we received when we come to faith in Christ, then we would understand there's nothing that can overcome it. Because they could do what they want to our bodies, but our soul has been secured, it has been redeemed. The Lord has put his down payment on it, and he's collecting when he returns. So don't worry about what could happen, because God has sealed you for himself. And in the case of David, he went out to do a task that God wanted him to do, and he knew God wasn't going to let him down. Goliath was not going to duck those stones and throw a spear through David. It wasn't happening that day. The whole army behind David might have thought it. In fact, I can see some of them chuckling and placing bets on how fast Goliath was going to kill David. Can't you? They were probably doing that. How much you got on Goliath? Oh, I got this much. There might have been one or two guys that wanted to take that odds and say, I got David. Maybe he'll get lucky. But it ain't going to be luck. It wasn't luck. It was faith that guided his courage and guided those stones to Goliath's forehead. Because David's faith was even bigger and stronger than anyone else in that army, from start to finish, he trusted God. And for those who are veterans in the military, especially if you've been involved in combat, you know how much courage and trust it takes to go into battle, to be prepared for battle, to do the things that could cost you your life. I can't imagine this. He's got thousands of people staring at him, watching his little self jog out to meet Goliath. And what a shock when he took Goliath down. And it makes me wonder, what did the Israelites think then? Obviously, they were riled up to go finish the battle off, but what did they think in that exact moment? Were they ashamed that they lacked faith to trust God? Because when God told Israel, I'm with you and no army is going to overcome you, even if that army is bigger and better equipped and more prepared, it doesn't matter. If I'm on your side, your ragtag army is going to conquer anybody. But they lacked that faith. But this little shepherd boy went out there and proved them all wrong. David trusted that size doesn't matter to God. David also trusted that salvation is from God and not from man. David practiced exactly what the New Testament teaches us. Salvation is a gift from God that we cannot earn. Instead, we receive it by faith. David proves that, and his faith is so powerful in this story. And even though it's way in the Old Testament, in the middle of the history of Israel, it is still such a shining example of the faith we are called to have in our daily life in this world. David didn't ask for a regiment to go with him, did he? He didn't say, hey, king, give me a division to back me up. He didn't say that. In fact, he even shed the armor that Saul gave him. He wasn't used to it. It was clumsy. And he says, I don't need this anyway. I got God on my side. He didn't take armor. And I'm pretty sure Goliath was getting a kick out of this. Not only was a little boy coming his way, but he didn't have any armor. He didn't have a heavy sword. He didn't have a long spear to throw at me. I can't imagine how cracked up he was. Of course, he had it coming. That God was delivering. All David did was he took a slingshot, a shepherd's sling, and a few stones, and he went out knowing that that slingshot was just a formality. because God was the most powerful weapon he took on that battlefield. We must stop taking inventory of our own skills and accomplishments and simply trust that God has done the work for our salvation and he continues to have victory over sin in our lives. David was fighting a military battle. So for him, it was both spiritual and physical, both spiritual and military. And he had to use the weapon provided to him, again, to finish the task that God set for him. But for us, we have weapons as well. But our battles are spiritual. We fight a spiritual fight in this world. So we need spiritual weapons. In Ephesians, it tells us this: put on the full armor of God. And unlike the one that David gave him, ill fit, believe me. So that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, and with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes with the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. God never leaves those who trust in him without the means to fight the battles he sent us into. David only needed a sling and a rock to kill one giant. For all the Goliath strength we can imagine we have from head to toe, all the protection we need, and we have the most powerful weapon, the word of God. The sword of the Spirit is the sword of the word of God, and it's the mightiest weapon we can swing. My wife, Allison, is a big Zelda fan. Anyone play Zelda back in the day on Nintendo and other devices? Oh, man, she's going to be mad today. No one played Zelda. Well, Zelda was this fantasy game where this elf warrior would go fight these evil things to go save a princess. Sounds like every other video game does it. But in the game, historically, in Zelda, there was always one particular weapon that would do it all. And I had to find an excuse to use this prop today. This is called the Master Sword. This is a replica. And we're nerds, so we occasionally collect things we have no business collecting. But in the Zelda video games, it all has this theme that in order to conquer the worst of the worst, you had to have the Master Sword. This was the weapon that would defeat the final boss. And in some games, you had to go on a quest to achieve it. Now, in those video games, this is what it took. In our life, we carry with us a sword that is the word of God. But, you know, it doesn't look like this. It's not shiny. It doesn't have a blue hilt. In the video games, it power comes over like He-Man. That's not what our sword looks like. Our sword looks a lot different, doesn't it? Look at this. Now, mine has a fake leather binding, so it looks a little good, but it's nothing to brag about, is it? It's not shiny. It's not sharp. It doesn't intimidate you like this, but you know what? This is more powerful than any piece of metal, steel, whatever we could ever do. Think of this. And I don't mean the actual paper. I mean the words within it. This is your weapon. God does not leave you without the means to overcome. He does not leave you without the means to protect yourself, to protect others. And he does not leave you without the means to conquer this world in a spiritual sense. That is to bring the gospel message to everyone. This is what it does. All the other armor is there to protect us, but this is our offensive weapon. This is the one that we use to conquer for Jesus. We're not like other religions or cults that have to use this to get converts. We use this, and we use the Spirit, and we use the heart. So it won't look like this, but you can buy this for a nice price. But this, the grace of God, is free. Scriptures are free. You need a Bible, I got a Bible. You need a sword, I will equip you with every sword of size you need. Miss Mary, you need a long sword, I'll get you one. Imagine her with a Braveheart sword this tall. But you know what? I can guarantee you, and she's used her sword effectively. She's slashed through the enemy, hasn't she? And you can too. So don't think, never think, that God's leaving you empty-handed. He doesn't plop you down on a battlefield with no armor, no weapon. That's not the God we serve. That's not the God we love. Salvation only comes from God, and David knew this. And he trusted in God, and the Spirit was with David that day. And because of that, he defeated a giant, a literal giant. Now for us, our giants are spiritual and metaphorical, and sometimes they look like they take the form of something physical, but we know, as Paul said in Ephesians, it's all about the evil behind it. We trust, we need to trust, that we can conquer sin and help free others with the weapons that God provides. Trust was the key to all of David's victories. Whether it be David and Goliath or whether it be any army that he faced in the future, they were all based on the trust he had in God to deliver him and deliver Israel through this. And this is the same trust and same faith that will carry us to victory in our daily challenges. It's only possible because God has already won the war, as I always say, but we are here to keep on fighting the battle on his behalf to win more souls for him. When we trust in God, we learn that no weapon, no power, no size of any obstacle can overtake or separate us from God. We trust that our faith is all we need. Even the size of a mustard seed can conquer anything. And when we trust God, we know only he saves us from both our past sin and present challenges, and he equips us with the weapons we need. David, this young shepherd boy, overcame a giant. And yes, it may be cliche to some, but we too can overcome our giants. But the key is, it's not about how we do it. It's about God doing it through us. It's about God preparing us, because God has the power to save. So today, remember that David didn't do it because he got a lucky shot. David didn't do it because Goliath just was lollygagging and wasn't paying attention. David defeated Goliath because God gave him that victory, and he trusted in God every step of the way. It's all about trust and faith. And that leads us into our invitation time. To believe and to trust is the beginning of faith, and it's the beginning of our salvation. For those who have not made Jesus Christ the Lord Savior, have not accepted that free gift of salvation, we now invite you now, if you believe, to repent of your past sins and to turn your life away from that and turn it to God, to confess him as your Lord and Savior today and to be baptized in his name. That is what he's calling on anyone who believes in him to do. So if that is your need today to come forward, we invite you to come forward to give your life to Christ. If your need is membership, you need to ask anything about membership or salvation itself, or if you have any prayer requests or praises you wish to bring, don't hesitate to do any of that either as we stand and sing our song of invitation.
The Lord God Almighty, the one.
God. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. And rainbows of living colors, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory to power be to you, the only wise King. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Thank you. I have a few things to announce. First off, I think everybody here knows and has been praying already, but we lost the cotton gin building yesterday, and it caused quite some damage, and we've lost that building. But, you know, I have to start with a praise that nobody, as far as I know, has been hurt. And I thank God that no one was. Let's give God a hand. And many of you know much more intimately than I do, but the cotton gin is like it's a very much a historical place in this community, and we don't know what the future holds for the Wright family, but we want to be in prayer for them and all the employees and all the individuals connected with that, because they lost a second home, so to speak, in a place that is very important to our community. So let's from now on, let's continue to pray for the owners, the co-workers, and the whole community as we've lost this place. But in the meantime, keep praying, because we're going to keep thinking about ways we can help and contribute to that. So let's be in prayer for that. Moving on to the news in the bulletin, you see that our trunk or treat or Halloween is coming soon on October 27th. And Lisa and Kim have reminded me that there's still a need for candy, and there's also a big need for small little toys and trinket prizes, kind of like Dollar General type of toys that are given out as prizes and stuff, supplies like that, and also small bag chips. This is another need. So there's several different needs. If you can come by, swing by and talk to Lisa or Kim and sign up for these, we need that, or any kind of way that you can help out the event. This is a great tool we have to communicate and witness to the community. So if you can, stop by and sign up for something to help with. Also coming very shortly on November 1st, which is a Friday, is the next ladies rally. And let me tell you, they got a nice spread. Now, how do I know that? As a guy, I snuck in illegally and took some snapshots of their setup, and boy, they beat me pretty bad and threw me out. But ladies, I'm telling you, this is a very nice event, and please consider attending on November 1st. Also, several other dates coming up in November. Please keep that on your minds. And, of course, November 3rd, which is coming very soon, so I'm going to start reminding you now, we fall back in time. There's always excuses. Preacher, my old-fashioned clock lost its battery. No, you got phones now. Use your phones. The satellites will tell you what time it is. Okay. So, guys, thank you for being here today. And if you are a first-time visitor today, please stop by our welcome desk and get to know Mr. Tom, and we'll get to know you. And thank you for being here today. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for today, Lord. We thank you that we were able to worship you and to praise you and have fellowship with one another, all united by your one Spirit, Lord. And we thank you for the ability to just thank you for everything. Thank you for our life. Thank you for our resources. And most importantly, thank you for the salvation we have through your Son. We thank you for all those things, Lord, and we just pray that our worship doesn't stop here, it continues. It continues in our daily life, that we live for you and we serve you. And Lord, we pray as we read once again the story of David and Goliath, we pray that even stories that many of us have known since childhood, we don't want to ever forget the main points. It isn't just a fancy story that's told to us to excite us, to give us action. It's a story to teach us truth. That you, God, can deliver us from anything. That you, God, can empower us to overcome anything in our lives. But it all starts with faith and trust in you. And most particularly in your Son, Jesus, who you sent for us to believe in. We thank you for your Son. We thank you for his sacrifice. We thank you for all of your blessings. And we pray that your Spirit would be with us as we leave. Protect us and guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Strength arise as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait upon the Lord. Strength arise as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong like eagles.
Strength arise as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait upon the Lord.
Strength arise as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait. Our God will reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverance.
do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak, and you comfort those in need. And you lift us up on wings like eagles. We'll reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. And you do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak, and you comfort those in need, and you lift us up on wings like eagles. You are the everlasting God, and you do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak, and you comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
That was all tricky.